Mr. Wallace, who's presently serving 10 years for manslaughter in an English jail, was known to have links with British intelligence.
Wallace claimed he was an intelligence officer. Wallace alleges he became involved in a black propaganda campaign by the security services.
There was no evidence to support the claims of Mr. Colin Wallace.
Until anybody can produce proper evidence, there is no need to have an inquiry.
Colin Wallace had fractured Mr. Lewis's skull with a karate-style blow after he was accused of having an affair with Mr. Lewis's wife. He hid his friend's body in the boot of his car and later dumped it in the River Arun.
He says he was the victim of an MI5 dirty tricks campaign.
The IRD as a Foreign Office department had to justify their position in Northern Ireland. And they justified it by emphasizing the international links of the IRA, by saying this is to do with Ireland, this is to do with the communists. And oddly, this is to do with the Vatican City as well, playing at the Catholic angle. The IRD tended to work through newspapers. They would draft articles in London and then distribute them through friendly journalists to slip into foreign newspapers. They worked with publishing houses where they would write some book about communism and then it would be distributed or published through a private commercial company.
Hugh Money, do IRD, foi enviado como conselheiro para a política de informação.
Northern Ireland was the most surveyed country in the world. Every citizen probably had a file. Every household was under surveillance, down to minute things like extra pint of milk. Just bought a new TV, where's the money come from that?
Colin Wallace, professor de imprensa de 27 anos, pediu para ajudar a unidade de guerra psicológica.
Because I grew up in Northern Ireland, because I knew a lot of the background, I was then asked to explain some of the significance in terms of emblems, in terms of labels, and so on and so forth. I was really bringing into the PsyOps team the Irish dimension, as it were, in terms of history, emotions, symbols, sounds.
Maurice Tugwell, diretor da Escola de Guerra Psicológica do Exército e veterano da campanha de contra-insurgência colonial britânica, comandou a unidade PsyOps. Maurice Tugwell acreditava que todas as agências de informação na Irlanda do Norte devem falar com uma só voz. Qualquer organização crítica à política britânica era uma fachada do IRA.
Information policy, PsyOps, was a highly sensitive activity, and it really needed some form of cover that gave its officers access to the public and the press.
A política de informação estava no mesmo prédio, no mesmo corredor da assessoria de imprensa.
So a visiting journalist going down the corridor to the press office would almost see the whole corridor as part of Army Public Relations, or as a key part of that had no bearing on public relations per se.
Em agosto de 1971, o governo britânico aprovou a internação de dissidentes sem julgamento. Muitos dos prisioneiros não eram terroristas, mas ativistas irlandeses dos direitos civis e nacionalistas.
The perception at that stage was a bad one globally. And of course, the IRA were very good from a PSYOP's point of view. They used that to make Britain look bad.
Relatos de tortura emergiram na imprensa irlandesa.
Were there allegations of brutality? The Information Policy Unit planted with selected journalists the fact that the techniques used by the security forces in questioning detainees were actually less demanding than the techniques we used on our own soldiers when we were teaching them how to avoid or deal with interrogation if they were captured by the enemy.
Histórias de tortura e prisão arbitrária sem julgamento fizeram crescer o sentimento de injustiça histórica e, com isso, a popularidade do IRA aumentou. A violência aumentou de todos os lados. Em 1972, 479 pessoas foram mortas e quase 5 mil ficaram feridas.
Each day, the psychological operations team would look at the violence of the past 24 hours. Some activities would require a quick response. We needed to do something that day. But sometimes there were themes developing that, for example, some type of terrorist activity was creating a problem. And therefore, we would have to take a more strategic look at that.
Um tema era uma questão ampla que a política de informação identificava como preocupante. Os principais tópicos incluem o apoio às comunidades de organizações paramilitares, que foram retratados como grupos criminosos organizados que intimidavam e exploravam comunidades locais. A política de informação tentou disseminar incerteza e conflito em grupos-alvo. A percepção internacional do conflito era outro tema importante. Os temas foram usados para colorir eventos, com mensagens que apoiaram as campanhas da política de informação do PSYOPs a longo prazo. Quando os jornalistas visitavam ou chamavam para a assessoria de imprensa do Exército, eles eram passados para Colin Wallace e seus colegas.
We then, from a PSYOPs point of view, either had an agreed position which we would take on this, feeding in the various themes that we wanted to put across, or in certain cases, we had a number of journalists who were much more pro the role of the armed forces in Northern Ireland, and we would then call them direct and explain the background that we wanted to put across.
The propaganda was deliberately designed to create conflict, to disorientate the IRA, to unnerve them and to, again, to separate them from the community whose support they needed in order to remain a viable organization.
We discovered at one stage they were using nitrile benzene to mix with fertilizer to make their bombs more effective. We discovered that nitrile benzene had a carcinogenic quality. And therefore, there was a real danger that people mixing these explosives, unless they were protected properly, were likely to develop cancer at a later stage. Now, this was a scientific fact, but exactly how much exposure, etc., we had no idea. But because there were sufficient scientific hooks with that, we circulated that information to the press. And the good thing about it was lots of experts from the scientific world agreed with the conclusion that nitrobenzene was a carcinogen.
Os jornais levaram a história e citaram um porta-voz anônimo do exército, que não era outro senão Colin Wallace, que alegou que sintomas de nitroenvenenamento são difíceis de detectar. Quando são visíveis, é tarde demais para tratar a vítima. Vômitos, seguido de coma, e mais tarde as glândulas e fígado se decompõem. O Guardian relatou, crianças que o encontrem armazenado em uma casa abandonada ou pessoas forçadas a armazená-lo, pode sofrer de envenenamento.
On occasion, bombs would go off prematurely, and quite often the people transporting the bomb would be killed. And where we got a bomb going off prematurely, although we knew the reason from the subsequent examination of the device, why it had gone off prematurely, we would quite often try to shift the reason for that onto something else.
Em campanhas políticas, o exército de PSYOPs trabalhou com Hugh Money, do IRD.
One of the themes the IRD used in its propaganda was trying to link the IRA to the Soviet Union and the broader communist threat. And so one of their plans involved telling journalists or leaking a story that Soviet submarines were dropping subversives who had been trained by the KGB off the coast of Ireland.
IRD acquired at one stage some photographs that the Royal Air Force had taken of a Soviet submarine off the coast of Scotland. A dossier was then built up by IRD, creating a credible story that this submarine, which then had moved off the coast of Donegal rather than Scotland from the story point of view, that this was clear evidence that the Soviets were directly involved in the violence in Northern Ireland. So IRD set up a meeting with the News of the World in London. We took across photographs, various other documents and material to substantiate the story. This was given to the News of the World, who ran as a front page lead. It was a huge story, and it got wide circulation again around the world.
Hugh Mooney se identificou para o jornalista como membro do Ministério das Relações Exteriores.
The Foreign Office was a cover for the activities of IRD, and therefore he was listed as a senior member of the Foreign Office, and that's how they knew that he was a genuine official. We would try to manipulate the terrorist organization simply by information, just to delay and get them to lose faith in what they were doing. But at the other end of the scale, there may be a technical intervention where, again, one would try to get, for example, a weapon to misfire or to explode or something of that nature.
On one occasion, the IRA was struggling with using heavier weapons such as bazookas. And it turned out that they were using them with the safety cap still on. The IRD decided to conceal this explanation and instead issue a dummy army order suggesting that the shells be tested electronically. The IRD hoped that this would result in explosions going off in the hands of IRA members.
Uma unidade clandestina na Irlanda do Norte, chamado Força de Reação Militar, vestidos como civis, feriu e matou numerosos católicos em tiroteios. A política de informação alertou os jornalistas que as armas usadas foram as que os grupos paramilitares carregavam. Como resultado, a imprensa atribuiu os ataques a grupos paramilitares. Em um dado incidente, a polícia descobriu que uma unidade do exército, disfarçada, tinha ferido um grupo de pessoas a tiro em um ponto de ônibus, em Glen Road, em Belfast. A polícia queria prestar queixa. PsyOps desarmou a polícia, ameaçando revelar que a munição usada tinha sido oferecida pela polícia ao exército. A política de informação criou relações próximas com jornalistas e com suas publicações.
The whole thing is about knowing the target audience, but also knowing the journalists as well. Sometimes, the relationship was very good, and it was almost at a humorous level. And journalists might ring me up and say, "Look, I'm quoting you as saying this," and I would say, "But I didn't say that." And they say, "I know, but we knew you would say that." And it was at that level, unless that quote was really way off mark, I would be quite happy with that. 99% of the work I was doing was unattributable. And then you also have off-the-record information which, you know, a journalist would know but couldn't actually report on. So literally that would just be built into their story without any reference to where it came from. Professional journalists are very good because they realized that if they didn't actually stick by what is a journalistic agreement after all, then probably we would not cooperate with them in the same way in the future.
How important is it for PSYOPs to be believable?
The press have quite often said that PSYOPs was largely about propaganda and using disinformation. But in the vast majority of cases, we were working on real intelligence. See, real intelligence is much more powerful because when the terrorists check out their own sources, it has to be credible. They have to be able to stand it up. If they can show it's false, then of course it's a waste of time and it really doesn't go anywhere. So most of the material that we use, most effective stuff, was genuine intelligence and had to be credible not just from a journalist point of view, but it had to also be credible from a terrorist point of view.
Em 5 de agosto de 1973, um artigo no noticiário Belfast Sunday News relatou que ovelhas tinham sido sacrificadas em um ritual de magia negra na praia da ilha Copeland, nordeste de Belfast.
It was a front page headline in the Sunday News, which lots of people read. The story was that sheep had been ritually killed and mutilated. That was the story. And that it was Satanists who had done this. As a would-be anthropologist, an undergraduate at the time, it tweaked my interests, and I began to pay attention as other news stories appeared in other local papers. The more I looked, the more I found, and I began to be really surprised at the degree to which this had been a local newspaper story in Northern Ireland.
A partir de agosto de 1973, histórias de bruxaria e magia negra começaram a emergir em muitos jornais locais.
First thing that I had to do was try and understand what witchcraft would look like, and we had no idea. So I bought a book on the subject. Then the whole idea of the sacrifice of animals or whatever it might have been, we got blood from the cookhouse, from the army cookhouse, and we would scatter that over the makeshift altars that were there. Some of that material then we left, and it would be discovered by local people, and then eventually they would talk about it at the press. And gradually the story built up and built up over a period of months. This was a way of really getting the interest of the press, getting rumors going around, and therefore doing the things that we really wanted to happen.
Os locais dos rituais eram frequentemente localizados em cemitérios antigos e propriedades abandonadas.
You have to remember that this was a time in Northern Ireland when all kinds of unusual things were happening. Assassinations were a very regular thing, and some of them were particularly bloody and brutal. Torture, mutilation, using knives and blades and things like that. People were talking about ritual murders and all kinds of things. So all of a sudden, all of the moral certainties no longer seem to be quite just as certain.
A política de informação enviou cartas de leitores falsos para a imprensa local para ajudar a expandir os rumores.
Quite often, on different subjects, we would write to local newspapers, drawing attention to something or criticizing something, and then the newspaper would publish that. And it would usually be about a local issue, and it was very much done at local level. But then we would pick up the publication of those letters, and we would then circulate those letters to more to the national press to reflect what would be portrayed as local views. Don't forget that we're not just influencing the press. The press is only one way of influencing the public. We had to be able to influence all sorts of other people who were, communicating with the public. And the churches then, in the 70s, had much more influence, of course, than they have today. And therefore, this involvement of witchcraft was quite important. The key thing we wanted the clergy to do, I think, was just to try and go back to reject all types of violence and questionable behavior. And whether that was drugs or witchcraft or terrorism, it was to say that these activities really have no place in the society that we were trying to create. And because at that stage people's world was dominated by the fear of terrorism, we were directly linking a lot of these things together. It was important to look at evil, bad, and terrorism all within one package.
They were particularly interested in getting at the Protestant population and getting them to believe in this stuff. They were trying to scare the bejesus out of the local population and to attach that fright to the terrible things that were going on, ergo the paramilitaries. That's, I think, what the core job of what they were doing was. They were trying to discredit the paramilitaries. They were trying to associate them with bad things, drug dealing, dodgy financial dealings, etc., etc.
We were just saying, look, the fact that the community has now sort of dissolved into this violence, which is becoming more and more sadistic in terms of sectarian assassinations, you know, where do you draw a halt as a community? I think it helped to bring home to people that there was something going on in their community that really was not good for them as a whole.
That is a strange way of thinking, because, you know, you are part of the army and the idea is that you are fighting a war. But you are saying the witchcraft campaign was about bringing a sense of morality back to the community. You wouldn't really have thought that the army would think about that.
Probably not, but I think, you see, it is a war, but it's not a conventional war. Terrorism is fundamentally a propaganda war that is backed up by armed conflict. So it was just, I think, going back to say to people, you know, you have grown up, as I did, in Northern Ireland with a very strong belief in the community and in our own church, whatever that religion was, and surely we have drifted a long way from that as a result of the violence of the last 5-6 years.
Em 8 de setembro de 1973, o corpo queimado e mutilado de Brian McDermott, de 10 anos, foi descoberto perto do Rio Laga, em Belfast.
People began to speculate, was this a black magic killing? And it certainly contributed towards one of the threads in the rumors and fears that autumn, which was that Satanists were looking for children to abduct.
Os jornais relataram rumores de que um menino ou menina com menos de 7 anos seria sacrificada.
The police actually issued statements saying they believed that the murder may have involved witchcraft. I was a little concerned for us at that stage, because bearing in mind that we were creating this concept, at that point we stopped using witchcraft as a concept.
But that was in September. And according to Richard Jenkins, the witchcraft scare continued all the way to the beginning of 1974.
I think that's right. And one of the points we were making is that when you create a story, it gathers momentum over a period of time. And I think although we stopped doing things, there were lots of other stories and rumors going around. And there may also have been people, you know, creating these things for fun, really, to do that. But we certainly stopped after Brian McDermott's death. There's no doubt about that, I'm absolutely clear. But it may well be that the aftermath of that was still going on for a period of some time, even to the beginning of the following year.
Desde o início de setembro até dezembro de 1973, havia mais de 70 artigos referentes à magia negra e à bruxaria. No início do ano seguinte, o tema tinha quase completamente desaparecido da imprensa. Quando o primeiro-ministro britânico Harold Wilson visitou a Irlanda do Norte, foi posto a par de tudo por Colin Wallace.
Would the Prime Minister have been aware that you were, in fact, in military intelligence?
Oh, I don't believe they would have been. I'm sure he saw me simply as an army press officer.
Did you yourself have a brief for when you interacted with him?
Yes, what happened was that there were certain key things that we felt the Prime Minister should know. So the idea is that you don't want him to be wrong-footed by not being able to answer the basic questions about security in Northern Ireland.
Influenciar a imprensa, clero e os principais tomadores de decisão foram alguns dos aspectos da guerra psicológica. Outro era influenciar pessoas de interesse diretamente.
Quite often we were trying to influence people where we had no direct access to them. And so when you're trying to move somebody or change somebody's thinking, sometimes you had to target them through one or more sort of relays of other people. So it's never straight communication. A lot of information we were disseminating wasn't through the media, it was also through people. And therefore, they had to be cut out so that the person handling it quite often didn't realize who the originator was. And that made it all the more credible when that person who was known to the target was passing this information on to them.
A política de informação criou perfis de pessoas de interesse e pessoas em suas redes sociais.
The key thing was that when you knew a lot about a person and the people they worked with, like any other part of society, there were people who didn't like each other, there were people who were jealous of each other. Because we had the relevant intelligence, if we could plant it in the right way, you could, for example, if one person was suspicious of another for some reason, you could increase that suspicion by feeding information in that would tend to reinforce their own views of that individual. So it was that type of activity.
Could you explain more about the kind of techniques you used to create psychological conflict?
I have to be careful with that because what I don't want to do is actually share techniques that are still having impact. And so there's a gray area there, but it's basically along the lines that we're saying, first of all, is to identify relationships, look at how toxic those relationships or not may be, and then try to maneuver them by planting information in to have that effect. You build up quite a comprehensive profile of that person and their associates. Now, it may be that some of those associates are totally innocent of any involvement in terrorism whatsoever. They just happen to be good friends from school days and so on and so forth. It's really creating a picture of that person so you almost know what their response will be to something that you do.
This is a very different use of psychology. And I think a lot of people wouldn't be aware that this knowledge exists and that people study psychology, you know, for these kinds of purposes.
I think that's true, but you have to be careful because we did do lots of things that had a positive psychological effect. Like, for example, we ran youth clubs, we ran community relations. I was the Army's Father Christmas, going around schools and hospitals at Christmas. We actually provided funds for projects. We took kids away from the really bad areas of Northern Ireland, from opposite sides of the fence, Catholic and Protestant together. We took them away to the mountains, camping.
Colin Wallace foi negada a permissão para atacar protestantes paramilitares de alto escalão em operações psicológicas. Esses indivíduos, que às vezes conspiravam com o exército britânico, estavam em uma lista excluída. Vários clérigos protestantes e políticos, por outro lado, eram alvos legítimos. PsyOps almejaram para indivíduos que não eram membros de organizações terroristas, mas que tiveram uma influência em comunidades de interesse para PsyOps. Na comunidade católica, conflitos pessoais foram a razão mais comum para uma pessoa se tornar um informante.
We couldn't admit to what we were doing, the army didn't admit to what we were doing, and so forth. A senior figure, political or military, might ask us to do something. And then for political reasons, usually, they would say, it'd be a really good idea if X happened. But then they would quite often say, but I don't want you to tell me how you go about it because I may have to deny it. And that was a classic example. So in other words, the person doesn't want to lie that they were involved in it.
Figuras sêniores foram deliberadamente mantidas no escuro sobre as especificidades das campanhas, para que pudessem negar envolvimento se lhes fosse solicitado que respondessem a perguntas. Aos 29 anos, Colin Wallace era o mais novo oficial sênior de informações da MOD. Durante seu tempo no Política de Informação, ele foi apresentado para as honras do Ano Novo 3 vezes por seus superiores. Em 1973, o IRD foi retirado da Irlanda do Norte. O IRD se concentrou em enquadrar conflitos tanto em casa como no exterior, como parte de um choque de ideologias entre o comunismo e o Ocidente. A inteligência do exército viu o IRD como envolvido na propaganda política de relevância limitada para o seu antiterror e campanha de contra-insurgência.
The military feared that having the IRD in Northern Ireland was undermining the credibility of their own PR campaigns. And Lisbon, the army headquarters, was becoming known as the Lisbon lie machine.
Não muito tempo depois da partida de Hugh Mooney e o IRD, uma reunião foi convocada no castelo de Stormont, sede do MI5 na Irlanda do Norte. Nesta reunião, uma campanha foi lançada, nome de código Relógio Laranja. Colin Wallace foi convidado para fazer contato com um agente com o nome falso de John Shaw.
He never came to Army headquarters at any time when I was there. All the meetings I had with him were at the White Gables Hotel. And I think the idea with that was that there would be no direct link, particularly with some of the information that we were using, between him and the army.
Colin Wallace afirma que John Shaw forneceu material que incluía podres sobre os políticos dos três principais partidos políticos na Grã-Bretanha.
Why do you think you were given that information, considering the sensitivity of it?
No, say this was background, because if we're looking at, for example, the increase in violence, that has to be put in context, particularly if you're briefing journalists in depth or foreign journalists. So you have to explain at that stage what led up to the violence. So in other words, the violence was really the activity, but the background was coming from the briefing papers that I was given.
Some of the forgeries that Information Policy and MI5 and IRD concocted in Northern Ireland came into my possession. To Merlin Rees, who at one point was the Minister for Northern Ireland, this is apparently from the American Congress for Irish Freedom, 1971. This was an IRA front in America. This is a letter apparently thanking Merlin Rees for his support, which of course Merlin Rees didn't support it, but there you go.
De acordo com Stephen Doriel, algumas das nódoas que Colin Wallace soube através de John Shaw já estavam em circulação na Grã-Bretanha.
Britain had a very sophisticated system whereby there were scores of people around the country whose job it was just to sit in bars, coffee bars, talk to people, go to clubs and spread rumors. And gradually kind of build up this idea about someone or some operation. It was smears about sex, accusations that Wilson had affairs.
O primeiro-ministro britânico, Harold Wilson, tinha sido pego em um escândalo sexual em uma viagem a Moscou.
There were accusations about, which is again kind of interesting in retrospect, about him being too close to Jewish people. So there were kind of anti-Semitic smears that Wilson was corrupt, that he had secret bank accounts. A few years ago, the son of a MI6 officer contacted me and said, you've written about my father, but did you know that when he retired in 1970, he went into the city of London and he started a newsletter and spread rumors through this newsletter and smears about Wilson?
Here's another fake, a Swiss account held by Edward Short, who was the leader of the House of Commons at the time, I think, another Labour MP, a fake bank account showing he had £30,000.
A journalist who trusts somebody like Colin can easily be manipulated. He would say to somebody, okay, yeah, I think I know so-and-so, talk to that person, or I can supply you with this bit of information, or I have this document I will allow you to look at, which will back up what I am saying, or what this person has told you. It's a very sophisticated kind of system. This is thought out about what it is you want to achieve with this particular story. This might be part of a chain. It might be part of an operation that's ongoing, with the idea that you kind of sway the argument or you change the view of something, smear somebody.
Em outubro de 1974, em uma reunião com John Shaw, Colin Wallace exigiu prova de autorização política para o Relógio Laranja, Ele nunca mais viu ou ouviu de John Shaw novamente. Colin Wallace voltou sua atenção para minar a rede de apoio republicano nos Estados Unidos e Irlanda. Ele criou um dossiê ligando angariadores de fundos e empreendedores que apoiavam os republicanos no contrabando de armas. Colin Wallace foi capaz de ligar os números de série das armas apreendidas em Belfast a traficantes de armas nos Estados Unidos. Identificou um angariador líder e grandes benfeitores. A ideia principal é que a história fosse um exclusivo para uma grande publicação. A seção conjunta irlandesa do MI5 e do MI6 mencionaram, num telegrama, que o editor-chefe do Daily Telegraph estava preparado para dar grande cobertura ao artigo. Colin Wallace foi convidado para fornecer fotografias adicionais. A política de informações gerenciava um departamento de fotografia que reunia imagens para fins de inteligência. Essas imagens podem ser usadas como material de suporte em briefings de imprensa. O Daily Telegraph publicou uma investigação especial. O repórter Christopher Dobson escreveu: "Passei os últimos 2 meses investigando a maneira como o IRA recebe seu dinheiro. Eu viajei para os Estados Unidos e Irlanda para conseguir localizar números de série das armas capturadas em Belfast. E eu olhei para as vidas dos mestres do terror." A imprensa ajudou a política de informação a localizar indivíduos e organizações-alvo, a que PsyOps não tinha acesso direto devido à sua localização geográfica. O artigo não forneceu nenhuma prova sobre o financiamento ou contrabando de armas. No entanto, o leitor foi deixado com a impressão distinta que indivíduos e organização foram responsáveis. William McGrath era um indivíduo proeminente na política leal, na Igreja e na Ordem Laranja, e o chefe de uma organização chamada TARA.
I was asked to encourage the press to look at what TARA and McGrath were all about. TARA was an organization that was really designed to prepare for a doomsday situation by loyalists if there was an IRA campaign, or in fact, as McGrath said, the Irish army might even invade the north. Attending the meetings of TARA, there were members of the Ulster Volunteer Force, which was then a proscribed loyalist paramilitary group. And there were also police officers attending it. In 1973, McGrath issued a proclamation. It was designed to make the Roman Catholic Church illegal.
William McGrath também foi o chefe da Casa de Kincora, um lar para meninos com passados conturbados, entre 11 e 18 anos. Colin Wallace emitiu 3 instruções separadas sobre McGrath, mas a imprensa não continuou a história. O exército foi informado, por um dos ramos especiais, que se eles se movessem contra McGrath, isso se tornaria num grande golpe de propaganda para o IRA e prejudicaria significativamente a estrutura política na Irlanda do Norte. Em dezembro de 1974, Colin Wallace foi convocado para o Ministério da Defesa em Londres.
Everything, as far as I was concerned, in terms of my job, how I was regarded by annual performance reports, all of those things were perfect. And so I was a bit surprised to be told then by the senior MOD official who saw me that because my life was in danger, I had to be moved out of the province.
Uma festa de despedida foi organizada. Um proeminente cartunista gravou a partida de Colin Wallace.
I moved to my new post, and a day after that, a police officer from Northern Ireland arrived with a special branch officer and said that they were investigating the fact that I had given a restricted document to a journalist. For the past 6 years, I'd been supplying, you know, as part of my job description, highly sensitive information to journalists from different countries around the world.
Sem o conhecimento de Colin Wallace, MI5 tinha feito uma avaliação em quão descontente ele estava e que agora ele era um risco de segurança. A audiência disciplinar que se surgiu concluiu que Colin Wallace deveria ser demitido. Em contraste, ele poderia manter a sua pensão caso se demitisse voluntariamente. Peter Broderick, um colega de Colin Wallace nas relações públicas do exército, tentou apoiá-lo e foi informado de que Colin Wallace foi um membro de uma organização terrorista. Peter Broderick foi então transferido para fora do Ministério da Defesa.
When my disciplinary hearing was finished, I realized that clearly it had been rigged, and I then engaged a solicitor purely for personal protection to tell him what had happened to me.
He said that he was involved in dirty tricks against politicians in Northern Ireland, and he also said that this had now started to move over onto the mainland, and that he was involved in a dirty tricks campaign against mainland politicians, and in particular, he mentioned Harold Wilson.
Colin Wallace se mudou para o sudeste de Londres e começou a falar sobre seu trabalho na política de informação. Ele pressionou os MPs, forneceu informações para a imprensa e escreveu para o ex-primeiro-ministro. Harold Wilson já tinha suspeitas de que MI5 tinha minado a ele e ao seu governo e que ele tinha comunicado isso a dois jornalistas.
He thought they'd mounted a campaign of denigrating him personally, of using official material that had been gathered and then misused by leaking it to newspapers.
Eles lançaram um livro que foi largamente ignorado. Em 1977, o IRD foi fechado silenciosamente. Isto foi feito depois de uma investigação interna sobre a conspiração contra o ex-primeiro-ministro.
I corresponded with Lord Hunt. He was asked to carry out the investigation into the alleged plots against Harold Wilson. And he spoke to a number of people, including the heads of MI5 and MI6. And he said that there was a plot, that there were dissident elements within both organizations. He wrote that report, which went to the new Prime Minister, and a copy of it was supposed to have been deposited in the Cabinet Office. I asked the Cabinet Office where was the copy, and they said they could not find one.
Colin Wallace, sem saber da morte do IRD, começou uma nova vida em West Sussex. Em janeiro de 1980, o Irish Independent publicou um artigo sobre o abuso de meninos na casa dos meninos Belfast Kincora. Os chefes da casa, William McGrath, Joseph Mains e Raymond Semple, tinham abusado sexualmente dos meninos aos seus cuidados. Políticos na Irlanda do Norte exigiram um inquérito completo.
The body, which was found last Friday in the river, had head injuries. And this is a matter for the pathologist who is making his examination to find out whether in fact the person died as a result of drowning or as a result of the head injuries.
Colin Wallace had fractured Mr. Lewis's skull with a karate-style blow during a meeting at his house after he was accused of having an affair with Mr. Lewis's wife. He hid his friend's body in the boot of his car and later dumped it in the River Arun.
Colin Wallace foi acusado de assassinato. A acusação alegou que ele estava apaixonado por Jane Lewis, a esposa do falecido. Ele foi considerado culpado de homicídio culposo e condenado a 10 anos, a 20 de março de 1981.
Sixty-five-year-old house father William McGrath, seen here in the foreground. He ran two Bible study centers in Belfast in the 50s and 60s. McGrath was also a founding member of the Protestant paramilitary group Tara.
This man was one of McGrath's victims.
And he would come up looking to get dressed, and then he'd start doing things he don't like, you know, he says. And so one time I was bleeding, I told him to stop. It wasn't pleasant, like this. He couldn't turn to no one, you know.
One of the Army's former press officers at Thiepval Barracks in Lisburn, Colin Wallace, is now a key figure in the Kincora investigation. Mr. Wallace, who's presently serving 10 years for manslaughter in an English jail, was also known to have links with British intelligence. Kevin Dowling, exactly what did Colin Wallace tell you in 1973?
He certainly said that McGrath was a homosexual. You must remember that the conversation I had with him was in 1973. I don't remember the conversation entirely clearly. It has been suggested to me that McGrath was in fact some kind of an army informer, and that the police felt obliged to protect him in order to bring to book greater criminals than he.
Exactly what part did British intelligence play, and were they aware that William McGrath was employed at Kinkora?
Arquivos do Exército Britânico relacionados com a Casa dos Meninos Kinkora desapareceram do quartel-general do Exército. Há rumores de que William McGrath era um informante do MI5. McGrath, Mens e Semple, que gerenciavam a Casa dos Meninos Kinkora, foram sentenciados em dezembro de 1981. Todos foram liberados em menos de 2 anos. Enquanto isso, Colin Wallace estava apenas no início de sua sentença de 10 anos.
When I first got to know him, he was in prison. And it was bizarre. He was actually protected in prison. There were other prisoners believed him. And he actually had kind of bodyguards, because they thought, probably correctly, that he might be killed, assassinated in prison.
Clive Ponting era o chefe do departamento Ministério da Defesa Legal em 1983 e lembra de uma reunião com o MI5 onde Colin Wallace era o assunto.
There was never any suspicion that Wallace was making these stories up and it was all totally unfounded and very easy to rubbish. It was very much a matter that that the story was being contained at the moment because he was in jail, but that in a few years time he'd be back out again and be expected to start making the allegations again.
Uma noite, na prisão, Colin Wallace leu um artigo sobre Fred Holroyd, um ex-oficial de inteligência militar da Irlanda do Norte, cuja experiência tinha suficientes semelhanças com a sua própria. Colin escreveu uma carta para Fred pedindo ajuda.
When I got to the prison, I realized this was the same man that I met in the secret corridor who had an office in Army headquarters. The MOD repeatedly were refuting that he was anything more than a civilian clerk with a Walter Mitty complex. And yet here he is with an office in this secret corridor with the political officer, MI5, MI6. All of the people who were running the army were in that office. I went on the same day the murder was committed. At the same time, you know, you've got every man and his dog walking along that path. You've got fishermen overlooking it about 100 yards away on a bridge. You have all sorts of courting couples walking along and boats going up and down the river. The thing was, you know, Trafalgar Square on a Saturday. The story that the police had put out was a lie. I also discovered a witness who had seen the dead man after he'd allegedly been killed by Colin. The police persuaded her not to give evidence.
He was sitting by the window with the gentleman he was with. A man in approximately his 50s with thinning grey hair combed back over the top of his head. And as far as I remember, I think he was in a grey suit. Whatever exchange came from Jonathan Lewis, it was sharp and then back to looking at it and fiddling with his glass on his knee. He looked far from happy.
She was frightened of the police. She thought the police were in on it.
Fred Holroyd procurou o barqueiro que tinha encontrado o corpo.
And he didn't know who I was. They all get very frightened when I arrive and start asking him questions about things that they're worried about themselves. And he said, I can tell you that the buggers wouldn't let me give the evidence I wanted to give, which was, you know, that I'd reversed back and my propeller had hit the guy in the face. And that's what caused the wound. And I said, you're kidding. You know, he said, no. So I said, are you prepared to put that down in writing? He said, well, if I have to, but the best thing would be to get me in a court and ask me questions, and then I have to answer in a courtroom, and the police can't do me any harm.
When Colin was still in prison, he was, via his solicitor, he was sending out various documents that he'd written. I was unemployed, and in those days in Hull, in Mrs. Thatcher's Britain, in a place like Hull with unemployment at 10%, if you had something to do, and I did, the people on the dole would leave, ignore you for years. So I carried on doing this journalism stuff.
Lobster, uma revista obscura feita em uma fotocopiadora, com circulação de 150, foi possivelmente a única na Grã-Bretanha naquela época a acreditar nas alegações de Colin Wallace.
I wrote this, which was, you know, 50 pages, an attempt to explain Colin's story. We printed quite a lot of these, about 1,000 copies, I think. And we went to London and had a press conference. So two hicks from the sticks turn up carrying this complicated, this big document and say, here's a big story. The media were not impressed at all. Virtually no response to it.
Em janeiro de 1987, Colin Wallace foi libertado da prisão.
A journalist called Julian O'Halloran went to Lewis Prison, actually filmed Colin Wallace as he stepped out of the prison gate and interviewed him. And it was going to be broadcast on Newsnight. I was actually watching Newsnight when there was a great kerfuffle in the studio. Something had happened and bits of paper were being looked at and headphones were being checked. And what had happened was the Wallace segment had been yanked at the last minute by a man called Alan Prothero, who at that point was deputy director of the BBC. Prothero was a part-time army officer in the Territorial Army, and his speciality was media-military relations. I went down to visit him and Fred, and it was the middle of winter. We were sitting in Colin Wallace's unheated house. He'd come out of prison and he couldn't afford to heat it. And so we're all sitting in our coats in Colin's living room, and I remember saying something like, so your plan is that me and you two guys, with no money between us, are going to take on MI5 and the MOD. Yes, that's the plan, they said.
A emissora irlandesa RTE pegou na história.
The record says that Colin Wallace killed Jonathan Lewis.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Did you?
No, I didn't. I had nothing at all to do with his death. I wasn't involved in any way. But, I mean, if I'm not calm about it, if I panic about it, I create a fuss, I get excited about it, that's not going to change the verdict any quicker than if I stay calm and deal with it properly through the correct channels.
Eventually, I was hired by Channel 4 News. Colin had these handwritten notes that he claimed were he'd written down from this about this MI5 disinformation project against the mostly against Labour MPs. Robert Parker of Channel 4 News went to a forensic scientist called Dr. Julius Grant.
What chances do you think there are that these notes are forgeries?
Well, from what I've already said, the chances that they're forgeries seem to be rather remote.
And thus, these documents were in fact written, probably, when Wallace said they were written. While we were working together on bits and pieces about Wallace, another journalist in ITN, who was one of their crime correspondents, began feeding information he was getting from the MOD, the Ministry of Defence, denigrating Wallace. We were also getting similar stuff from Professor Paul Wilkinson, a terrorism expert, again denigrating Wallace and saying he's a fantasist and a liar.
O jornalista investigativo Paul Foote escreveu livro sobre Colin Wallace. Wallace começou a aparecer na comunicação britânica com mais frequência, incluindo no popular weekly debate show ITV Central Weekend ao vivo.
If you take the case of Mr. Wallace here, as everybody else who's ever convicted of any crime, poor Mr. Wallace was framed.
I don't believe he was framed.
The point that
it's
he met.
Any responsible journalist in Northern Ireland in the early 70s knew what Colin Wallace was up to. There was this gung-ho character who was running around at dead of night, shoving envelopes full of documents into the letterboxes of journalists. And you'd say, there's Collins at it again.
I was the first, probably the first person in the CIA who got into this dirty tricks business. They weren't as dirty as a lot of people
think. Yeah, because a lot of people find it very objectionable.
But it wasn't just a minute. It's to blacken someone's a hell of a lot better than killing. In World War II, we killed people. And then now, when we got into business, well, we're simply playing dirty tricks again to prevent having World War III.
You're the man that sparked all this off.
I did not join the security forces to discredit the Labour Party, the Conservative Party, the Liberal Party. And because I was deflected from my main job into doing political disinformation, I was not actually doing the job I joined to do.
Good evening. A civil servant sacked after making allegations about an MI5 dirty tricks campaign has been awarded £30,000 compensation by the government.
Alcott QC was asked to conduct an inquiry. In his report, he reveals that Ministry of Defence officials contacted Mr. Wallace's disciplinary hearing beforehand, thus influencing the outcome. The Defence Secretary, Tom King, asked Mr. Calcutt not to write a full report.
Labour's Northern Ireland Secretary between 1974 and 76 said he had been the victim of a dirty tricks campaign.
Who instructed Mr. Wallace to do the job that he and others did? That's what we've got to know. We want to be sure that this sort of thing never happens again. I feel very strongly about it.
Mrs. Thatcher, having insisted there was no evidence to back such claims, was forced to admit in the Commons that she'd been misled. This followed the discovery of documents in the Ministry of Defence which related to a propaganda campaign codenamed Clockwork Orange.
He's calling for the government to launch a full inquiry.
Injustice to me is really a minor matter. The much more important matters are the allegations that there was an attempt to influence the general elections in 1974 and indeed the assaults on the children in Kankora during the 70s. My aspect of the story really is only a minor one by comparison.
The government specifically ruled out the reopening of the investigation into the alleged cover-up of the homosexual abuse of boys at the Kinkora home in Belfast.
Information about homosexual behaviour at the Kinkora boys' home was used to blackmail prominent figures in Northern Ireland.
After I left Northern Ireland, another intelligence officer came in called Brian Gimmel. He was told about the allegations surrounding the abuses at Kinkora. He wrote a report about them. He submitted that report to a senior MI5 officer, Ian Cameron, who then told him to stop investigating.
You know, on the phone, we got phone calls of generals said, yes, I knew all about Kinkora, I was told, and I took it to MI5, and they said it was none of my business, and I left it to them. It was their business. And all this sort of stuff, and, you know, the realisation, like me, the light is dawning, that we are not who we say we are.
O jornalista David Leake localizou Dennis Payne, o ex-chefe do MI5 na Irlanda do Norte, em uma vida tranquila no campo, e confrontou-o com as alegações do relógio laranja.
I'm under an obligation to say absolutely nothing. I can't say anything at all. I mean, you collect all the information. I can't believe anyone is in the slightest bit interested in it. But I'm nothing to add.
Em 1996, Colin Wallace apelou da sua condenação por homicídio culposo.
Today, 15 years after he was jailed for manslaughter, Colin Wallace from West Sussex cleared his name.
He served 6 years in the 1980s after being found guilty of killing an antiques dealer near his home in West Sussex.
Durante a audiência de apelo, o patologista do Ministério do Interior admitiu que um agente do serviço secreto tinha sugerido a ele que a lesão foi causada por um golpe de karatê na cabeça, não pela hélice de um barco.
The hearing of the Court of Appeal focused largely on new medical evidence about the injury Jonathan Lewis received.
Jonathan Lewis was most probably attacked at the riverbank and not at his house. And he said there was no evidence that his body had ever been in Colin Wallace's car.
He says he was the victim of an MI5 dirty tricks campaign. Now Mr. Wallace is demanding a full investigation into his claims.
Mesmo depois que Colin Wallace recebeu uma indenização, seus problemas com MI5 não tinham acabado.
When I was working at BAA, MI5 contacted the head of security there, and then I was made redundant after that. Now, I can't say MI5 is responsible, but again, why were they still meddling in my case after all those years?
A imprensa transmitiu o apelo de Colin Wallace e expôs suas alegações. Mas eles não se questionaram que papel eles mesmos tinham tido na disseminação de notícias falsas e que lições eles poderiam aprender para seus relatórios no futuro. Colin Wallace pediu repetidamente uma investigação sobre as suas alegações, mas não era para haver qualquer investigação completa, apenas uma lista cada vez mais longa de inquéritos legais e disputas cobrindo décadas, enquanto as alegações desbotaram na opinião pública.
We now look at probably 5 inquiries that all failed totally to do what Parliament assured the public that it would do.
Still to this day, Colin is a problem. That there are major efforts to restrict what he says. Kinkora is a prime example. The boys' home where it is alleged intelligence people were involved, recruiting people, used people, etc. The inquiries into that have been incredibly restricted. And Colin, on one hand, would be told, yes, come and tell us your story, tell us everything. Then when it gets nearer, you get a document from the minister who says, I'm sorry, he can talk about that area, but no way he's going to talk about that. Or MI5, he cannot talk about this area because that gets him into an official secrets area. So even to this day, 40 years on, they are still trying to shut him up.
The whole system, you see, is unaccountable and it's insidious. It's easy for the MI5 to just say, no, we don't do it, because nobody can prove what they did or they don't.
Hoje, o papel dos militares e serviços de inteligência na fabricação e manipulação da notícia é considerado uma conspiração. Apesar da ampla cobertura da imprensa das alegações de Colin Wallace, nenhuma única pessoa em uma posição autoridade foi mencionada. Quando perguntaram a Hugh Munney do IRD, que estava sob juramento em um inquérito público, sobre seu trabalho em PsyOps, ele mentiu e afirmou que ele nunca estava envolvido em PsyOps, apesar das esmagadoras evidências em contrário. Hugh Munney se foi, sem qualquer problema, e tornou-se um homem de negócios bem-sucedido.
This is a very, very secretive society. It runs through everything. Secrecy is the British disease. It's not anything else, it's secrecy.
If you believe in the democratic process, there has to be oversight. And at the moment, we don't have oversight. Because vetting is an important issue for politicians who are looking for ministerial appointments, and service people or police officers moving into the higher level, you must have access to classified information. If MI5 don't agree to you having that clearance, if they take that clearance away from you, then your career is doomed. So there, you never know about it. It's an invisible threat that's hanging over people all the time. And therefore, the danger is that MI5 has almost an invisible degree of influence that really is way outside what it should be. And it's therefore virtually impossible to challenge MI5 on some of the decisions they make.
Politicians are careerists, most of them. They want to go up the ladder, become ministers. And if you start criticizing or investigating the army or the intelligence services, this will not do your career any good whatsoever. And this is also true for journalists, not a good career path. This is sticky stuff.
People are saying, well, why are you fighting with the army and the MOD? Surely you're a part of that. I'm only fighting with the MOD because I was given no choice. Because the MOD didn't even talk to me. If I hadn't fought when I did, I would probably still have a conviction, and I still wouldn't have got the admissions out of the government that we've now got. People realize that the full truth hasn't come out. And although authorities think they may have been clever and been able to dodge around the issue, public have a totally different view. People are pretty aware of when things are not actually truthful. And they know at the moment they haven't had the full truth about what has happened in Northern Ireland.
So could you share some of the areas of the troubles that are still closed?
I can't say precisely, because that would put me in jeopardy. And it would put Colin in deep jeopardy. But there are certain areas of the troubles which haven't simply not been talked about at all. You know, there are things about, there's a suicide in Northern Ireland of a military intelligence officer. One of the key events. It's an official secret. A suicide is an official secret. And so far, no one has written about it. And some of the events around that are appalling, in that he ran agents who were 14 and 15 year old Catholic schoolgirls. This is how desperate the army at some stage became to get intelligence. And you kind of say, how do you run a 14-year-old Catholic schoolgirl?
Na história de Colin Wallace, a imprensa ajuda a gerenciar o presente espalhando notícias falsas, e a mídia ajuda a digerir o passado, criando uma discussão sobre o passado. O papel dos departamentos de Estado na criação e formação da realidade não é reconhecido, e mesmo depois da mídia tornar-se consciente disso, não informa o público das implicações desta omissão. O poder não é responsabilizado, não há principais tomadores de decisão a serem responsabilizados, e eles e suas organizações nunca admitem ter errado. Os arquivos que serviriam como evidência das suas ações foram destruídos ou escondidos. Nesta história, a imprensa serve como um mecanismo complexo que ajuda a fortalecer e legitimar o poder. Alegações daqueles que fazem o mal e a injustiça acabam se perdendo em investigações legais e disputas que arrastam até hoje e em que a maioria das pessoas não entende ou acredita. Nos disseram que numa imprensa livre, o poder vai ser responsabilizado. Mas e os indivíduos e instituições que nunca serão responsabilizados e nunca foram responsabilizados? Deve a imprensa incluir a verdade em seu relatório? Ou algumas das verdades são destinadas a ser nada mais do que versões de notícias falsas?